Good evening. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Kimberly Mazik, and I'm the Associate Director on the Initiative on Catholic Social Thought and Public Life, and a proud graduate of the School of Foreign Service at Georgetown. Along with my colleagues and friends, including John Carr, who's not here tonight, but he wishes he could be and trying to watch from Europe, and Kim Daniels and Christian Sunan, I want to welcome you all here to our first Salt and Light gathering of this academic year. We also want to welcome those of you who are online joining us from across the country. I believe we have over 500 people registered to watch us online, and we have a nice full auditorium here. As many of you know, the initiative has hosted more than 150 dialogues with more than 300,000 people joining us either in person or online. We're glad to host this in-person gathering here at Georgetown tonight, which allows us also to have an opportunity for fellowship and networking with food and drink both before and after this dialogue. And what a conversation we have planned for this evening, focusing on how can we live faithfully in our personal, professional, and political lives. I'm so excited to hear from this panel about how we can build community and apply principles of human dignity, solidarity, concern for the poor and vulnerable, and care for creation in our personal, professional, and political lives. In Fratelli Tutti, Pope Francis says, at times, the frantic pace of the modern world prevents us from listening attentively to what another is saying. Halfway through, we interrupt him and want to contradict what he hasn't even finished saying. We must not lose our ability to listen. Tonight, we have the opportunity to listen to others as we sit with questions of work, relationships, faith, wholeness in these challenging times. We've brought together four remarkable leaders with differing expertise and experience to explore these questions. And to introduce them and to moderate tonight's discussion, I'm going to hand it over to my wonder colleague and friend, Anna Gordon, the initiative's program director and also the leader of our Salt and Light gatherings. Anna, I pass you the mic.
Hi, everyone. Thanks so much for being here tonight. Thank you, Kim, for that lovely introduction to our very first Salt and Light gathering of the year. We're so happy you all can be here. I know there's familiar faces in the audience and new faces. Some people brought friends, so we're so happy you're all here and everyone joining us online. We're of course so grateful that you're a part of this too. As Kim said, tonight we're talking about how we can live faithfully in our personal, professional, and political lives. We're gonna be wrestling with the question of how we bring our faith, our relationships into the public square and how we engage with all of that. In the United States, as we know, there's widespread polarization and hostility in our public discourse. As we look ahead to the 2024 election season, politics often seem paralyzed by this division and neglects really important and serious challenges like poverty, climate change, and protecting the most neglected and vulnerable voices in our communities. We also know that millennials and Gen Zers are struggling in their personal lives as well. Isolation and loneliness are widespread, and it's increasingly difficult to build meaningful relationships with our coworkers, our friends, our romantic partners, and our neighbors. There's a question of what role religion and faith play in all of this, too. So we're here tonight with this amazing group, our wonderful participants up here on stage, our wonderful audience, and everyone watching online, to talk about this and to listen, as Kim said, about how Catholic social teaching can help us break through this polarization and this loneliness. One night at World Youth Day, I'm also going to quote Pope Francis, as young people were gathering to prepare to walk the stations of the cross, Pope Francis urged those young people to walk with Jesus on, quote, the path of your suffering, the path of our anxieties, the path of our loneliness. When he was among us, Jesus walked. He walked along healing the sick, caring for the poor, doing works of justice. So I hope we can all walk together tonight and listen to explore what our faith is calling us to and how we can live faithfully in our personal, professional, and political lives. So let me introduce our four outstanding leaders we have for this conversation. Eric Bazail-Eimil is a Cuban-American writer, commentator, and journalist. He is a 2023-2024 fellow at Politico and has previously interned at the Wall Street Journal, NBC News, and Reason Magazine. Tamika Mason is the Director of Faith Outreach for Assistant Democratic Leader James Clyburn in the U.S. House of Representatives. She has worked on Capitol Hill for Representative Clyburn since 2007. Luke Russert is the author of Look For Me There, Grieving My Father, Finding Myself, and was an award-winning congressional correspondent for NBC News. And Elizabeth Ferrardo is an active duty U.S. Army major and an active term member at the Council on Foreign Relations. And in 2009, she qualified as an Apache helicopter pilot and served two combat deployments in eastern Afghanistan. When we get to the Q&A period, we'll be taking questions from our audience here at SCS. And for those of us joining on the live stream, please share your thoughts on social media using the hashtag LivingFaithfullyGU and by tagging GUCST Public Life on X or Twitter and on Instagram. So let's start the conversation. Luke, I'm going to come to you first, and I'll ask each of you the same question. How does your faith help you find hope, purpose, and meaning in your personal, professional, and political life?
It's a good question. Let me start by saying thank you for having me. True story, last week my mom forwarded me an email, and it was this event, and the top line was, "You should go to this." And I said, I think I'll be there.
She didn't read.
I don't know. I don't know about the panelists, but you know, she didn't scroll down. She just saw the top of it and goes, "You should be there." So, okay. So if my mom's watching, I made it. Hi. You know, my first memories of the church were I was a little kid and I would sit in the pew and play with my Matchbox cars, not really know what was going on. You know, maybe 3 or 4 years old. And I remember one day I asked my father, I said, "Why do we go to that dark place with all that music and the weird light and the windows, you know, once a week? Why do we do that? I don't understand." And he had a very simple answer. He said, "You know, you've been very blessed with a lot and you need to take an hour every week to remind yourself of those blessings and where they come from and what more you can do for others." And he said that to me when I was 5 years old. And I've always remembered that. So I think what the beauty of faith is, especially in our Catholic tradition, but it is everywhere. I've traveled the world and I've seen it in so many different ways. It centers you. And I think that centering is so needed because if you look at one of the most constant things we see is change in the world. And we are changing at such a rapid clip with technology, with social norms and customs seemingly being blown out of the water every single day. But there is the resiliency of faith. There is the resiliency of that belief that I'm going to take it a half hour, an hour every week to reflect upon my role in this world and the blessings I've received and how I can do onto others. So it goes back to those Matchbox cars in the pew when I was four or five. Just take a moment and do well.
That's great. Tamika, how does your faith help you find hope, purpose, and meaning in your personal, professional, and political life?
Yeah, so I would agree with what Luke just said. Faith is my foundation. It's who I am. As like he said, growing up as a child, that's what my foundation was based off of, my faith. And so to this day, and I hear it echo, so I don't know if that's me or not, but...
No, you're good.
But like you said, the world is changing so rapidly every day. So I have to do reminders. Mm-hmm. Like I have scriptures everywhere. Like when I wake up in the morning, there's a scripture on the wall that I read every day. Mm-hmm. There's scriptures on my desk that I just keep. And I feel like in the middle of so much that's going on, you need those reminders. So if I put it up where I can see it, I can be running around the office, you know, trying to get something done. And then I'll see that. I'll read it and then I feel myself kind of calm down and, like he said, recenter. Mm. So I think it plays a lot into just having those reminders. Like he said, taking that time to recenter helps a lot in all areas of my life.
I love that. I got to print out my scripture and put it up now, I guess. Eric, how about you? How does your faith help you find hope, purpose, and meaning?
You know, I come at this from an interesting perspective because I didn't grow up in the church. I was baptized in the church, but I ended up actually receiving First Communion, and I was confirmed when I was a student at Georgetown. and came under the influence of the Jesuits. And you know, one of the things that I think it has really informed for me, especially as I've matured into my professional career and continue maturing, is that my faith shapes my perspective on the world and it frames my worldview. Especially like our Catholic theology is fundamentally rooted in constant promise of renewal and redemption. So for me, every single day, it forces me to look at the people that I work with, but also the people I cover with a great deal of love and empathy. And I don't do it perfectly, right? But I always know that every single day I can do my job better and that there's always a chance to do it. And that promise, I think, is what always makes me hopeful that I can make an impact in my work and that my work can be impactful and my industry can be impactful.
Mm. Powerful. Liz, finally, let's come to you. How does your faith help you?
Yeah, and I hope we get to come back to what you said, because I would say that that cuts across all of our experiences too. But so I went to West Point and graduated in 2007. So I've been in for 16 years at this point, and I think I've moved 13 times during that experience, to include graduating from high school and then having to report the very next day. So, if you know anything about Long Island, where I grew up, not really a hotbed for military recruitment. So certainly a lot of culture shock going on. But as I heard from my friends here, the same feelings of isolation and loneliness, I think that I have felt at various times throughout my career, whether that is showing up at a new duty station or having to take a new job, that's not necessarily unique to my experience as a military officer, but just finding myself in very unfamiliar surroundings. And I would just share real quick on my first deployment, they separated our flights going over from our intermediary base to Afghanistan. And it was only a difference of 18 hours in which I found myself separated from the rest of my cohort. But you might as well have told me that I was going to be in Timbuktu while everybody else was going forward, because I just had no sense of reassurance that I would end up in the same location reunited with all of my colleagues. And I remember there was a tiny base there with a small chapel, and I just went in there and bawled my eyes out for 30 minutes and then came back to my soldiers and was able to kind of collect myself and feel like, all right, we're going to be okay. We're going to get there. But yeah, in the midst of great change, in great uncertainty and periods of self-doubt, my faith is very much an anchor for me to feel like I can continue to move forward and make progress.
An anchor, recentering, redemption, those are all parts of faith that I love as well. Luke, let's talk a little bit about you. I'll hold up your book here, which I read and it was amazing. Everyone should buy a copy from their local bookstore. But in addition to writing this book before that, you were most well known for your award-winning career with NBC News. You won an Emmy, right?
I did. You
also co-hosted a show, I love this, on Sirius Radio, called 60/20 Sports with James Carville, which is just, I got to listen. I got to listen to that. And you wrote this book that came out just a few months ago about the death of your father, Tim Russert, who was the moderator of NBC's Meet the Press. And you talk about your journey of grief and faith and self-discovery. Can you tell us about your dad for people who may not know who he was and about how his passing affected you? And what role did your Catholic faith play in that grief process?
Well, let me start off with the latter part first. I mean, I think the one great thing about being Catholic is we know how to do death very well. So, and that was something that, at least for me, was very helpful, is that I remember one of the first priests I saw was basically, we've been here before, we'll be here again, and give it up to us. And that was one of the things my father used to say. He said, part of the privilege of faith is knowing that you're just one small part of a grand design, your immortal part, and you have to give yourself up to that, and the world goes on. My father was moderator of Meet the Press, NBC, Washington Bureau Chief. He had worked on Capitol Hill for Senator Moynihan, was a young chief of staff, and also worked for Governor Cuomo, two Catholic legislators, and I think faith was always a very guiding part of his career. Whether it was in South Buffalo where he grew up, it wasn't what street you lived on, it was what parish you were a part of. and then the CYO and going to Jesuit high school and Jesuit college. And he proudly wore it on his sleeve. One of his favorite stories was there was a profile done about him, and one of the quotes was Tim Rustard, who admits to being a practicing Catholic. I'm admitting to being a practicing Catholic? What is it, like, I admit to drinking alcohol? What? And he always kept that one up there. And it was a reminder that, you know, not everybody might feel the same way he did about his faith, and that sometimes you had to take the bumps and bruises that came with that. You know, when he passed, it was obviously something that was very difficult for me, as I recount in the book. I think when you have the grounding of faith, it certainly provides a wonderful outlet to center yourself and to understand that, you know, there is another world and beyond. I think for me, what was very, very important was just the way in which people came together at that moment. And it was really started at the church. Mm-hmm. And it was that sort of constant comfort. As I said in the beginning, we've been here before and we'll be here again. And that's something that I think, you know, you can carry with you, which is very important. You know, one of the priests I learned from at Boston College, he said something that I always remembered, and my father really believed in this too, is that, you know, you carry the values of Christ when you leave the door every Sunday.
Right.
And I think that goes full circle. So for him and for me, but to the best, you know, we're not all perfect all the time either.
So you talked about your dad's Catholic faith and his career. What role has faith played in your career? And what do the Catholic Church's social teachings mean to you? And how do the principles like our call to advance human dignity and justice and solidarity with the poor and vulnerable, how does that affect your approach to your work and life?
And one of the things that I was very proud of when I was at NBC is I didn't fear talking about faith, especially with politicians. And I often thought that the Catholics, especially in politics, often got pigeonholed into issues where it was always about whether gay rights or reproductive rights. And you'd go there, and I remember I did an interview on Christian Broadcasting Network one time. They asked me to come on. I said, okay. And the question was, are reporters mindful of faith? I mean, do they do a good job of reporting about faith? And are they snarky? It was trying to set me up to sort of do a slam dunk on, oh, yes, it's a bunch of communist reporters that hate everybody, right? And I answered the question. I said, well, I think one of the big issues is that we pigeonhole people, whether it's, there's a huge evangelical movement that's very pro-environment and very concerned about climate change because this is God's green earth that we are destroying. You don't hear about that very much, right? The whole notion of Catholic social teaching that you focus on helping the poor, especially on immigration, right? You don't hear that nearly as much as you do on the other side. So I think it's important that we have that conversation, which is that if you look at the totality of what the teachings are, it is not all hell and brimstone, fire and brimstone, right? There's a lot more there. And that's something that I've always sort of held on to. Now, the last thing I'll say is the other great thing about the Catholic Church is you can find someone to the right of Attila the Hun, who's a priest, and you can find a priest that makes Che Guevara look like a capitalist, okay? But what's that mean? It's a big tent where we're all welcome and it's an exchange of ideas. And I think one of the things that Pope Francis has done very well, and I was so proud to have covered him in 2015 when he came here, is he's increased the awareness of that, and he's encouraged that conversation. And that's very, very important. We as Catholics should not have these endless civil wars. We should talk about it. That's what the Jesuits do well.
I'll do a shameless plug. That's what we're trying to do here at the Initiative. So thank you all for being here for that. Tamika, I think it makes a lot of sense to go to you next, and it's so great to have you here with us. As you've all heard, Tamika's had a really impressive career working for Representative Clyburn for more than 15 years. And in your current role, you work with faith communities. And so you've seen that nuance that Luke was talking about. So tell us about your work on the Hill as the director of the faith outreach. What have you heard from faith communities, and in particular young people, What do they say about the connection between their faith and politics?
So we work with, well, I don't know if everyone knows, so I'll just explain a little bit. In addition to my boss being the assistant Democratic leader, he's also the chair of the Democratic Faith Working Group. And through the Democratic Faith Working Group, we try to do just what Luke says. We try to make sure that our members are connecting with faith organizations. For a number of reasons, we understand the vital part that the faith community plays in the community, and we understand that they are also voters. So they need to have a seat at the table. And so we build on that by having different roundtables. We do a lot of calls on, there's not an issue that we don't connect with the faith community on. We make sure that there's an open door for them to know that if you feel some type of way, send me your letter of support or your letter against whatever, you know, we may be dealing with, but we want to hear from them. Mm-hmm. So just like you said, this here was very timely because this is what we want to do. We want to make sure that people know about the Democratic Faith Working Group and the work that we're doing. And we don't have, like, we work with so many groups. I mean, they're like Circle of Protection, there's National Council of Churches, there's Islamic Relief, like everybody, you know, so that's all age groups. Right. You know, it's not just one group of a certain age, but we are open for everyone of all age. So I think just having that advocacy work and connecting with them on the Hill helps us with our work that we do every day.
Hmm. I wonder if we could turn a little more personal. Can you tell us what it's like to be a Christian working on the Hill? To be a person of faith working in a hyper-polarized environment? What are some of the challenges there, and what are some of the opportunities that you see?
That goes back to those scriptures that I mentioned. many times I need to take a break. I need to step away and just say, okay, what am I supposed to be doing right now? Like, where do you want me? Help me figure this out. I mean, just like in any other profession, there's the highs and the lows, you know, and you want to make sure that you're always doing or giving your best and setting a good example. And politics is very touchy. And so I have to find that space and that time to just take a break. Mm. And my boss is awesome. I'm not saying that because he pays me. I really, really mean that because I did not see myself, like, it was not a desire for me to work in politics. Mm. I went to Bowie State University and studied computer technology. Yeah, I see y'all's faces. Yeah, I thought I was gonna be working for like this corporate organization, like doing graphic design and websites and all of this. And God had another plan. Mm-hmm. And I just so happened to be in the right place at the right time, right? Looking back, I didn't know that at the time, but I was fresh out of college working for a lobbying firm. And through that lobbying firm, I met my chief of staff. And my chief of staff at that time, they were looking for a staff assistant. And I was looking for a job, you know, fresh out of college. I didn't know anything about Congressman Clyburn at all. He was the majority whip at the time. Democrats had the majority. And so when I came to meet with my chief of staff, he told me that they were hiring for someone. And I'm like, government job, good benefits, consistent work. No idea of all the other stuff, right, that was going to come with it. But I was just like, okay, I'm going to do this, right? And through this, I'm going to give y'all some real insider. I became a first-time voter during the Obama's first election. Mm. Politics was not something that I grew up with in my household. And so I learned a lot about politics in my 16 years with Congressman Clyburn, but getting to know him in his faith and how he speaks about his faith so freely when he's speaking, I was like, wow, I did not know that exists. Yeah. And I've always been a woman of faith. Like I said, I grew up in the church as a child. And so that was already in me. And I already had like work experience doing administrative assistant. So if you guys know, staff assistants, you maintain the office, you're greeting people, you're answering phones, you're making copies. I had all that down pat, but I didn't know the politics, right? But over time, I get to learn that. And that's something of, like, on Capitol Hill, you don't always come in through a certain path. Like, a lot of people, of course, they go to school, they have a desire, they study political science, but that doesn't mean that's the only way you get there. And so I think my faith played a huge role in that I did not have a plan, but the Lord did. And just being here today, as I mentioned to you before, I'm not a public speaker at all, but I like this format because it's conversational, right? It gives you a chance to tell your story, and nobody can tell your story better than you.
Yeah, we're just talking. Yeah.
Thank you.
Snaps for that. Eric, congratulations on graduating from Georgetown, a recent college grad over here. Like so many students I've met at the Hilltop, many of whom are in the audience tonight, you have a very impressive resume, including this new great fellowship that you have here at Politico. How did you discern your career path as a college student, and what role did faith play in that whole discernment process?
You know, it's funny, I did not come to college thinking I was going to be a journalist. I thought I was going to go to law school and I was going to become a federal prosecutor because I did mock trial in high school and I had a wonderful mentor who was an assistant U.S. attorney in the Southern District, and I thought that's what I was going to do. But, you know, I think there were events that occurred, like, when I was in college that made me question what kind of impact I could have in the criminal justice system. I never wanted to work in the private sector. And, you know, I think when I started asking those questions, I realized, one, like, the work I wanted to do, I wanted to feel like I, as an individual, could do something, even if it was minuscule, that I could push, you know, things forward within a tough system. And the second thing is that one of the things I loved about trial work and all these things was the writing and the storytelling. So, you know, when you, like, realize, oh crap, the plan I had for a couple of years is, like, kind of, like, disintegrated before my eyes, I was like, well, let's try everything. Very good spiritual mentor of mine at Georgetown, she always talks about collecting data for discernment. And I was like, you know what, I just need to collect data. I interviewed for a consulting job, realized I did not want to work crazy hours. And then I started, you know, exploring academia and realized, like, I did not want to write a dissertation. And then I ended up, you know, writing a column for the Hoya actually about faith and the Catholic Church and, like, what spirituality looked like during COVID. And it was at that point that I was like, I kind of like this regular editing. I was also, like, kind of, like, on the side writing articles for a blog about Florida politics because that's where I was during COVID. And it was an election year. And over time, I realized, like, no, I want to try this journalism thing. And I think, you know, God put a lot of really opportune moments in my career path. Like, I met some incredible journalists who mentored me and, you know, sponsored me and took a chance on me and, you know, showed me the way to some opportunities I never would have expected. And over time, I realized, no, this is exactly what I want to be doing. I really love the aspect of journalism, and I realize, like, I want to work with people primarily, and I want to be interacting with people's stories and figuring out, like, you know, how to explain complicated subjects in national politics and in policy to folks. And I think all of that in conjunction just made it feel like the right fit. So by the time I got to the Wall Street Journal, and now that I've gone to Politico, like, this is what I see myself doing for the foreseeable future. There's not really a plan B. Like, I guess I could become a Jesuit. Like, if I really, like, you know, consistent benefits, consistent employment, housing, you know, if I really needed a job, you know.
That's an ongoing discernment process.
Collecting data.
Yeah.
Well, let me ask you about your job at Politico. You clearly are connecting faith and politics. So what is your take on the current political climate in the United States? Broad question. But especially as we head towards the 2024 presidential election, do you see an opportunity to heed this call from Pope Francis about not letting our differences pit us against each other, but rather being open to ways of communion?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's not great. Like, our political climate is not doing really well. I mean, our institutions have had a lot of sledgehammers taken to them over the last couple years. I mean, the spending battles on Capitol Hill, the debt ceiling battles, the way that impeachment, like, has, you know, really become, at this point, a tool of partisan acrimony and voicing partisan acrimony towards a president. Those things, I think, all indicate that, you know, the rot has seeped in a lot. I think it's not incurable, right? I think that there are opportunities. But I think, like, you know, as a church, and I think as people in public life, like, we have to acknowledge that it's not going to happen tomorrow, right? Like, it is not, like, politics is going to take a long time to correct itself. I think part of it is, I think it's incumbent upon all of us to always be cognizant of other people's human dignity in the political arena. Mm. And I think on the media side, because I don't think the media, like, looks at it, like, we're navel-gazing, but not in the right ways. I don't think, like, sometimes we self-scrutinize in the ways we need to. And I think we have to ask more critical questions about how is the media, like, perpetuating an incentive cycle that doesn't contribute to dialogue. I think we more and more have to have these conversations and explore better ways of covering people's stories. I think over time we can get better. But I think, you know, I think it's incumbent upon all of us to say, like, this is a problem that we can start taking into our hands now, and over time we will see the benefits. The election's going to be tough. I think, like, we're going to see another tough election cycle. I was in West Virginia talking to voters ahead of Joe Manchin's reelection race, which is going to be one of the most expensive Senate races if he ends up running again. And the lines are pretty deep set, and it's an odd year. Like, it's going to be, like, that race, like, I think speaking to voters, they're really illuminated. Like, people have lots of complex and deep feelings about this, but the battle lines are set, and I think over time, we just need to start chipping away at that. And that's going to take some intentional work.
I'd love to revisit that because I think looking ahead, it is fairly bleak. But first, I want to turn to Liz for a little bit. Thanks for being with us tonight. I think it's safe to say that you're the first helicopter pilot that we've had at a Salt and Light gathering.
How could this be? Everywhere.
And like all of our participants tonight, you have a very impressive background. But you're also, unique to this panel, a wife and a mother. And so first, let me ask you, as a faithful Catholic, you've served our country as a member of the military. How have Catholic social teachings shaped and influenced your decisions and your leadership? How have they inspired you, and how have they also challenged you?
Yeah, first of all, shout out to Eric, my husband, who's doing bed and bath time with our two kids. So I can do this. But to go back to your second question first, I feel a lot of tension at times in my job because I professionally grew up in a organization that prizes obedience and deference and clear hierarchy, maybe not unlike the church in some ways. You know, I'm talking about the military here, and that is for good reason, because when bullets are flying or you're in a really difficult situation, that is not really the time to have a nuanced discussion about, well, what should we be doing here? You know, the Army makes it and the military makes it so that you can respond automatically to a variety of circumstances and react rather than have to think through. But that also doesn't leave a lot of time for debate and discussion and collaboration. But the reason why that's important, though, is that the other side of that is the military is inherently, it is a people business where you are leading people who may have different interests or motivations or come from all different walks of life. As I shared, you know, the experience of me being a young platoon leader and suddenly having responsibility for 40 men and women who many were older than me, you know, many were married and had children, and trying to really understand what was that like and how could I best serve them. And I guess the tension, or even if you, what I'll say is, even if you don't have military experience, I think DC is a good, still provides a good analogy, because if it's not a military hierarchy, you know, this is very much a town that is interested in power and proximity to power and influence. And I think certainly for myself, there have been times where I really have to ask myself, am I acting and behaving in such a way that I am not letting my ego get the best of me, and that I am working in service of other people and not just, you know, snapping my fingers and expecting things to happen, but actually working to build relationships. And again, I would just share, this came into very sharp focus for me on my second deployment, because we're in Afghanistan. We are tasked with providing 5 different mission sets a day to our partners, the ground forces, many of the soldiers that are conducting very dangerous operations on the ground. And even if you've never met a helicopter pilot before, I'll tell you that Apaches and all aircraft are very, you know, if something could go wrong on them, it will. So our margin for error is very thin in terms of making sure that we have functional aircraft and that we have the people to fly them. And I'm coming into land one day, and I'm trying not to land on the Black Hawk that's in front of me. We had been escorting them to these different bases. And in trying to keep them in my sight as I'm on the controls and coming into land, we end up developing a very excessive rate of descent. And my aircraft hits the ground at about 1,000 feet per minute. And we pivot hard to the left, collapse one of the struts on the aircraft, the landing gear, and we're able to safely execute an emergency shutdown procedure. And I'm talking to my co-pilot in the front seat, are you okay? And he says, my back hurts. And crash rescue comes out and they put him in a neck brace, they load him into a stretcher. And just to go back to what I was saying initially is I think I very much had a reputation as I was a pretty exacting commander. You know, my guys knew the score in that, hey, we have to get this done. And I did not always act with kindness and compassion. And yet now I am the one that is responsible for this huge catastrophe and possibly the livelihood of one of my soldiers. They take us to the hospital where we have to give blood samples, give urine samples, make sure that we're not under the influence of anything, which we were not. My co-pilot luckily ends up being okay. I am not okay though. You know, I am feeling terrible. And my boss brings me into the office later and he just says to me, you know, Liz, we have this horrible saying when it comes to aviation and accidents, and there are those that have and there are those that will. And I'm glad you're okay. Mm-hmm. And he just knew that there was nothing that he was going to say to me that was probably worse than anything I was telling myself in that moment, and that I would learn from it and do better and show my guys the same understanding for, you know, a fraction of the mistakes that would be made from here on out. But that was certainly a very painful, but also a very memorable lesson that stays with me and that I try to model, but continue to fall short of at times.
Thank you for sharing that. You talked about how some of the people under your supervision were parents and had children. Now you're also a mom and you have children. Can you tell us about how your Catholic faith is a part of and influences your family life?
We try to go to church. I spend most of it chasing my 1.5-year-old around, so I couldn't really tell you what the message is on any given Sunday, but it's the thought that counts. But I would say, you know, my kids are 4 and 1.5, so I have to lower my expectations and then probably lower them even more in terms of what are we trying to accomplish at this stage. But I've always liked that quote that you might be the only Bible some people ever read. And I always think about my, I think, you know, with Catholic faith and growing up Italian, food was also an integral part of our life. And I have very fond memories or strong memories of my mom one time, a classmate of mine, her father died very unexpectedly. And after school one day, my mom, instead of going home, we stopped at the family's house and my mom had a casserole that she was going to bring. And we weren't particularly close with this family, so much so that when my mom got out of the car and called out to this other mom, the recently widowed mom kind of looked at her with a vague, you know, not expression of acknowledgement, but my mom kind of said, she was like, oh, she doesn't know who I am. And she felt, I think, embarrassed or uncomfortable, but she still just got out of the car and said, you know, I'm so sorry, I'm Joan, you know, please let me know, we're here for you. And it's funny because I bring that up to my mom and like, she doesn't remember it after all these years, but it just stuck with me. And I think that acts of service, even if my kids might not understand and, you know, all the catechism and all of that, but trying to show them and model for them that Faith is showing up for people in their times of suffering and just being there for them. That is the example that I try to model for them.
Mm. I love that. Sounds like a busy house.
Yes. Hopefully they're in bed right now, though. We'll see.
That's great. Well, we'll open this up to questions from you all in a few minutes, but I did want to revisit sort of something that you touched on, Eric, actually all of you. I'm hearing these great examples from your own personal life, sort of in your own circles of practicing your faith. But I think on a national scale, what we see in public life is not at all conversational or active listening. It's deep, deep polarization, like what you were talking about from your reporting. Luke, I wonder if I could ask you, where have you experienced polarization or gridlock in your professional life? And how do you navigate all of that? And how has your faith played a role in the decision making?
Well, I had a very unique experience because I started out as a journalist in 2008. And after President Obama was elected, a lot of people thought that this was a new era of bipartisanship. It was a post-racial America, one of the largest, most overwhelming victories in American history. Barack Hussein Obama won the state of Indiana in that 08 election, won the state of North Carolina in that election. And what happened, and I saw this firsthand on Capitol Hill, was that it was evident that whether it was the stimulus package, whether it was the health care bill, whatever it was, a lot of people were scared. And I also think that having the first black president made a lot of people scared. And you started to see a wave come up. And I remember the first Tea Party rally that was ever on Capitol Hill, and it freaked me out. It was really crazy and weird. And they were so angry about journalists. They were vicious and screaming and spitting. And it also happened to be the same time when social media was on the rise. So I think we went very quickly in that time frame from having, all right, and I often say that my father's passing is kind of like the end of this era. The morning news, the evening news, cable during the day, and real print newspapers. Mm-hmm. 2010, 2011, Twitter comes out in a really big way politically. And suddenly we as journalists are having to go down all these rabbit holes that are coming up on Twitter. A lot of politicians no longer have to go through us as a filter. They're going straight to the people. Mm-hmm. And when you have that atmosphere, it gets hypercharged. The people who are the loudest voices in the room, the people who are the most of the bomb thrower set are the ones that get a lot of the attention. And so I sort of had the privilege of seeing this firsthand. You saw some politicians were able to react to it and understand the times are a-changing. There is a lot who were not. And then you saw a whole new class come in 2010 and 2012 and 14 that were really disruptive on both sides. And one of the stories I talk about in my book was I didn't know if I wanted to leave journalism, and I was struggling with the decision. And it's around May of 2016. My contract's up in a month, so I have to give an answer. And I'm going back and forth, and I'm like, I want to go know who I am outside of this town and outside of my last name and get to know my own identity. But man, this is such a great job, and there's such a future. Am I making the right decision? So I'm praying on it and praying on it and praying on it. And I had this story about a veterans issue on Capitol Hill that I was very proud of, and I'm all mic'd up and I'm getting set to do it. And they come into my ear and they said, oh, I'm so sorry, we have to scrap you. We have to take Donald Trump's reaction to the shooting of Harambe the gorilla alive. So that was God saying, I think you have the decision to make and we know which one it should be, all right? And I think that I tell that story because if we go back to 2008, right, and the election of Barack Obama to then that moment, it shows the arc of where we went as a country from the journalist side, but from the political side as well. And I think we're still dealing with the ramifications of that. One thing that I did notice, though, when I took some time away, and I'm just like to say I'm a recovering journalist, and I wasn't in the day-to-day, and I traveled a lot and saw how the rest of the world viewed the United States. I think one thing that we don't do enough is look at American politics through an anthropological lens. Hmm. And what I mean by, and I think that you're starting to see that a little bit now. Like, respectfully, It's absolutely crazy that you could have the same election from 2020 that you didn't have it now. It's crazy that you'd have an 81-year-old guy against a 77-year-old guy, considering the baggage they both have at this moment. And I think when you start to think about that and you peel back the layers, that's where a lot of this anger comes from. One of the things I was very fascinated about was when AOC got on the scene, she said something that, I wish I had said that, right? And what I mean by that is she said something where she's like, it's so weird to me that I come in and, you know, my staff barely has enough money to eat and get by. And as I walk to my office, there's literally just lobbyists on both sides, you know, who have all the money in the world. They're trying to give money to me for all these different reasons. I wasn't expecting that. Like, I thought I was going to come here and work for the people. And I thought about that. And at first I was cynical. It's like, what did you expect? This is Washington, you know. But then you think, like, yeah, I'm a few years out of this. Yeah, it is kind of nuts, right? And I think those are the types of questions that we need to ask more. Is, you know, who are we serving here? And there's a lot of good conservative ideas. There's a lot of good liberal ideas. But the way that they're put into motion, they're put into action now, it's gotten quite messy. Yeah. And the last thing I'll just say, that the story that I think doesn't get enough attention, that I think about too much. 2020, the Republican Party didn't have a platform. They literally did not have a platform. Like, I go back to that. Like, that should have been the number one news story for weeks. You have a presidential candidate who's an incumbent, and you don't have a platform down. Mm-hmm. And we just sort of have let that happen. And I think that's an important little story, because if we as voters accept that, or we as journalists accept that, recovering, we as anybody accept that, it's mm-hmm. problematic. Mm-hmm. It's problematic.
Thanks. And we'll now turn to some audience questions. I just want to say something that I love about Catholic social teaching is, if you look at the whole teaching, like many people have said, you don't fall politically into any clear category. And I think we need more of that nuanced discussion on the Hill in all of these conversations, because neither political party offers all of it. And so we need to be listening to all sides and hearing all perspectives. So does anyone have a question from the audience here? Again, if you're joining us online, please use our hashtag. Looks like we have one right in the back there. We'll start there. I'll use the John Carr line. Please introduce yourself and put your question in the form of a question.
Hello, my name is Esther. Thank you all so much for speaking today. It's been really edifying. I am working on Capitol Hill, and I'm very vocal about my faith. I love talking about it, actually, but a lot of times I feel like an undercover agent when I'm at work, and that's partly because I don't know the answer to the question I'm about to ask you guys, which is that being Christian publicly, I think, means recognizing the detrimental impacts that Christianity has had in the public square, especially in America, where, you know, Christianity has been the dominant influence and been in a privileged position for majority of the like country's establishment. So how do you recognize when people accuse the church and Christians, oftentimes rightly so, in your workspace, in the public space, without demurring away from or minimizing your own personal faith? And sorry, this is a longer subset of this question, but specifically in policymaking, perhaps, does this acknowledgement mean that we become champions of other religious groups or of atheists as they express like their needs and constitutional legal rights? So does living out our faith mean advocating for the freedom and the right for other people to refuse our faith? And what does like that advocacy for religious freedom look like for Christians?
Great, thanks. Tamika, can we go to you first, and then maybe you, Eric?
Okay, yeah, that was a loaded question, so I'm hoping that I'm answering it. So with the Democratic Faith Working Group, what we try to get our members to understand, you don't have to be of a certain faith to join the Democratic Faith Working Group. And, you know, you don't have to practice faith. You don't have to be of a specific faith. But the point is to recognize the role that the faith community plays in our communities. So we're very open with that. And you asked, so we don't have people who come to us, like faith groups don't come to us because I'm a Christian or because we have a Muslim on our group or, you know what I mean? In our case, it actually opens the door for groups to come to us. When they realize that we are diverse and open, then they feel like they can be included. And so that's what we've been trying to build over the years that I've been here. Just making sure that we are touching and agreeing with all groups. So I don't know if that answers your question.
Let's see. Eric, do you have anything you want to add?
You know, I was going to try to tackle that kind of undercover agent aspect of Esther's question, because I've been thinking about that a lot. When I started at one outlet and like I mentioned casually that I was going to mass or whatever and I needed to block off Sunday, like one of my coworkers who was about my age said something to the effect of, oh, I don't trust those Jesus people. I think that's very close to what he actually said. And I was kind of like, well, what do you think I'm going to react to that? But I think because of the obviously rich theological tradition of Christianity and also the cultural role of Christianity over thousands of years, like people can kind of, I think people sometimes interpret it as, you know, they can read into what you think and like how you act. So I want to honor like the premise of the question. I think it's tough and I think it can sometimes be a little awkward, but I think the answer is that you don't like, I mean, I think you should try to be as polite as you can, but never turn away from your faith through it. I think if you emphasize, I don't want to say don't be like Christocentric, like, or, you know, to not be, I'm not saying not be Christocentric, but emphasize, I mean, the aspects of it that also go beyond that, like the way that, you know, the church looks at the world and looks at people and emphasize that that undergirds your work. I think if you put your values first, sometimes like, I think that might like also reduce people's threshold for like concern or for alarm when they find out that you're one of those people, you know, quote unquote.
Those Jesus people.
Yeah.
Thanks, that was really thoughtful. We have another question up here.
Can I add one thing to that?
Yeah, please.
I just think it's important. Like, one of my favorite lectures I ever got from the Jesuits at BC was this, he came out and he said, Spanish Inquisition was one of the worst human rights violations in the history of the world. And it's true. When you're a Jesuit saying that, right? And the reason why I bring that up is I think that one of the beauties of the Catholic faith, but I also think it extends to Christianity, is that it's ever changing. And the ones who do it the best acknowledge the errors of the past. Mm. And it's a really supposed to be something in the way of how Christ lived, mm-hmm. right? Christ was with the fringes of society, the outcasts of society, the people who were looked down upon. Christ was challenging those in power, really a radical. Right? And so if you take that message and you pair it with what I think at least the Catholic Church does very well, I think a lot of Christian groups do very well. I've been to sub-Saharan Africa. I've been in impoverished areas of Latin America. I've been in far-flung villages in Asia. I've been in inner cities and rural areas of the United States, especially in Europe. What's the constant in all those places? The number one organization that is doing outreach on healthcare, education, it's faith-based groups. They are there. They're on the front lines. They're doing things. So we can acknowledge that and not have to apologize about that, and that's okay. And the other thing I'll just say with that is that I think it goes back to one of the areas where we get typecast, right? It's like, oh, you're gonna go bake your goods on your Sunday with your Jesus group and sing your hymns and sing Kumbaya and you don't have respect for anybody else who thinks differently than you. That's not the case at all. And I think it's way more of a bigger tent than we think.
That's great. We have a question here. Does anyone else have a question? I'm wondering if we could take two, maybe one other in the far back there. If you could both ask your questions, and then I know we're running a little late and we'll answer both of them. So if you could introduce yourself.
Good evening. My name is Christian. And my question is, a lot of times a very certain aspect of our church who are politically involved are the loudest. They're the most vocal. And so it, as Luke mentioned, it typecast what Christianity and voting looks like. Mm-hmm. But what I find in working with the church and participating in discussions is that we're not like that at all. Mm-hmm. And actually there's a real drive to be the salt of the world, right? The mm-hmm. light, salt of the earth, light of the world. And so as we're coming up on this massive election cycle that is going to be crazy, how do we encourage, how do we strengthen us to speak out, to be vocal. Rather, it's in our friend group or in our parish or at the coffee shop, so that when we talk about faith-based advocacy, it's not seen as some right-wing nut job. And then especially as Catholics that are people of color in our communities, standing up for the dignity of life, the dignity of all of the things that come with that, healthcare and education and adequate housing for everyone. Mm-hmm. How do we encourage that thought, those discussions coming up in an election cycle where the loudest in our church, the loudest in our political advocacy groups are the ultra conservative and sometimes a little discriminatory?
Thank you. If you take that question all the way in the back, think about which one you want to answer.
Thank you. Hi, mask working. Hi, my name's Steve. Thank you. I work and study here in the city. Thank you very much to cover the waterfront of all the panelists. Ma'am, Major, my dad is one of your older brothers in the branch, so thanks for your duty. Appreciate it. Congratulations, young man, on your graduation. You know, God be with you. Kudos to all the work that Congressman Clyburn's doing. When I was a much younger fella, not too long after I finished undergrad, I joined the top rated local news affiliate and network news bureau in the city. And the third among my bosses, aside from Wendy Wilkinson and the great Brady Daniels, was our author tonight, who I think is especially brave, BC graduate coming to Georgetown, but that's a different conversation. You have a story that goes a little bit farther beyond playing with matchbox cars as your introduction to the church. There was some story about a shirt. Totally yours, I think. I can't work in Latin. Is it totus tuus? So,
yes.
So if you could, for folk who don't know that story, I guess one of the earliest portions of your faith, could you recount that, please, Luke? And your dad was an extraordinary boss, but had an exemplary work ethic, and a lot of us who saw him up close pretty much attributed that to the political education he had by Moynihan, by Cuomo, and the Jesuits. Mm-hmm. So one of his favorite expressions to us was, as you probably know, just get it done. So how does that credo inform your work now? And to all of you, how does that sort of marching order influence your work? And thank you all, truly.
Thank you. I wonder if we could first, Liz, could you maybe speak to that first question about how we can encourage Catholics to speak out about their faith, especially as we go into the election, and then maybe Luke will come to you and we'll keep it tight and then we'll close up here. Yeah.
Yeah. I think quickly I would say, you know, the problem is I don't think that this is a situation where fighting fire with fire is necessarily the best approach, in that we adopt a equally verbose way of speaking out. I think for me, it goes back to the people that I have had a chance to observe and see their faith in action. When I think about what grounds me and what provides that example, it's seeing them use their passions for good. And I guess this is where I go back to Pope Francis and, you know, who am I to judge? But trying to use our time, our energy, our talents in being supportive of others, other groups, and using our energy in those endeavors versus using them to, you know, tear people down or expend a lot of energy as to explaining why the other side, whoever that is wrong or is otherwise misplaced. So I acknowledge that might be a deeply unsatisfying, but I have to have some level of optimism that that is ultimately the, by example, you can actually have a broader influence and maybe cut down on turn down the temperature in our current political environment.
Great. Luke, maybe just quickly respond.
Yeah,
to that.
So you bring up a wonderful story. In the 1980s, when my father first went to NBC, he was an executive in New York. He wasn't on air at all. And he was one of the executives in charge of the Today Show. And the Today Show was in those morning rating wars, and
My father had the idea of, let's do the Today Show live from the Vatican, and let's try to get the Pope to be on the Today Show. And the Pope was very apprehensive about it and kind of going back and forth. This is Pope John Paul II at the time. And of course, he survived an assassination attempt. And when he had survived an assassination attempt, he had said the prayer, Totus Tuus, which is, I am yours, to the Virgin Mary, essentially saying, in this moment of near death, I am yours. And so my father was a smart guy, and he knew how to get noticed at times when he needed to. He had me as a baby, and he had a T-shirt made that said Totus Tuus on the front. And as the Pope was coming by in a receiving line, he put me up like this in the middle. And so, of course, the Pope is going to do the blessing and the kiss. And so my father then took that opportunity and said, oh, hey, by the way, we're trying to get you on the Today Show for NBC. So it was a very heartfelt moment. A lot of great notice. But it's something that, there's a picture of it, and I look at that picture a lot because you can tell that even as an infant, the way in which my eyes are so wide that I'm aware of the magnitude of what's happening. I don't necessarily know what's happening, but I know it's yeah. special. And I still have that shirt, it's framed. So it's there. Thank you for bringing that up, though. It's very cool.
Well, I'm sorry we don't have more time. I know we're over time and we'll just go another 5 short minutes. But we hope everyone here in the auditorium can join us for a reception afterwards to continue this conversation. And thank you all for such thoughtful comments. And I'm gonna ask you for one last thing. And if you could give me a single word or a sentence tell everyone here in person and online, what is one action or one step that they can take to act in light of our conversation tonight? We've talked a lot. There's lots of reasons for concern, lots of things we can work on in light of our faith. So what's one thing people can do? And we'll just go down the line again. We'll start with you, Luke.
Notice things. I think people don't notice enough these days. We get lost very much in our own worlds, whether it's on our phones or all the pressures and dramas and schedules and notifications. Notice things. Notice the world around you. Take it in. See where it can be done better.
Great. Tamika?
I would say advocate. Be a part of the process. Mm. Don't sit back and let it be somebody else's job. We all have a duty to serve and to do our part.
Mm. Eric?
Take stock, I think, of what's around you. I think that so much of Washington is structured around kind of the active life and just constantly working and, you know, like the schedule and the rhythm of political life. Especially if you're around politics and policy, like take a step back and think to yourself, how is what I'm doing every day like meaningful? What kind of impact am I making? And are there ways that I can change that tomorrow or in the future? So, and always have those questions like forefront as you're looking at what's coming next, really. Always have that at the forefront of your thoughts.
That's great. Liz?
We all have crucibles in our life, whether that is a relationship or an illness or just stress, or maybe a paper that you have to write. So be kind.
Be kind, take stock, advocate, and notice things. That's a great, great takeaways. I do, before we close, want to preview some upcoming dialogues that we have lined up. In the second week of October, we're going to be holding a public dialogue on the release of Pope Francis's new letter that's coming out that builds on the teachings of Laudato Si, his groundbreaking letter on care for our common home. So stay tuned for that. And then the following week in October, we'll be having a Latino leader gathering here in this space again on strengthening social bonds and resisting individualism, contributions from Latino culture. And then on November 2nd, we have a really exciting evening planned. We'll be hosting the Washington, D.C. premiere of a documentary called Join or Die, which is a film about why you should join a club and why the fate of America depends on it. It's going to be a really great conversation. We'll do the film screening and then a dialogue after. And then on November 14th, we're holding a Dahlgren dialogue on Georgetown's main campus on solidarity with Jesuits and the Catholic Church in Nicaragua because of the situation happening down there. There's a lot more planned, but please visit our website in the coming weeks for updates on all of that. This discussion is being recorded and will be posted on our website and all of our social media channels if you want to share it afterwards. We also have follow-up resources on there with some links from some of our participants and other things. Thank you so much to the School of Continuing Studies and their whole team here for having us in this beautiful space yet again, all of our vendors who helped out, and a special thanks to all my colleagues, Kim Daniels, Kim Mazik, Christian Soonan, and John Carr, who's watching from over the pond, for all their support to make tonight such a great success. Thanks to all of you for joining us here in person and online, and please join me in thanking our panel, Luke, Tamika, Eric, and Liz.